right, as we walked over, we were talking about that. So today, we'll talk about DEI and why it matters. Sorry we're starting a few minutes late. It's the nature of the week, and it's only Wednesday. So I have some quotes. I tried to get each of the Western religions. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, we all rejoice together. You shall have one standard for stranger and citizen alike. In Leviticus, sorry, last one was from Corinthians. O mankind, we have created you male and female and appointed you races and tribes that you may know one another. Surely the noblest among you in the sight of God is the most God-fearing of you. God is all-knowing, all-aware, from the Quran. And I wanted to do that because I don't often quote the Bible, but we are a school affiliated with the UCC, and I thought with our Krieger Scholarship and just the nature of our world today, that to be inclusive for all Western religions as it relates to diversity, equity, inclusion, and that doesn't mean that I don't know there are other traditions and philosophies out there. Today, we focused on the Western religions. So today, we'll talk just a bit about current events. You'll get an overview of our DEI actions with assistance from Mercedes Clay, our Chief Diversity Officer. And we'll close with some campus notes and some dates to remember. So current events, as we all know, painfully know, a pandemic has plagued us for over 2 years. The death of George Floyd and many others spurred us to say enough, that we must address the systemic racism after 244 years in America. And now we watch the Russian invasion of the Ukraine, which has us anxious as what this could mean for us and the world. There's never a dearth of things to worry about, but there is sunshine and warm weather outside to keep us joyful and make us smile, to do what we can do, as my sister in New Zealand says, in our little piece of the world, to make a difference. That's what we're here to do. Overview of becoming a national model for DEI. First of all, it's a process. After the board meeting, I provided you an update with the board actions. I usually do that at a Campus Connections, but because we had a topic scheduled for this time, I thought better just to send in the update. So you have those board actions. If you haven't seen them and want to, please reference that update, which was sent, I think, midweek last week. The last time at Campus Connections, we talked about who are our students, and we learned about who they are, as well as how to support them. And today, we discuss why DEI is important to us, our campus, and the world. If you remember, in last session, we talked about the ethnicity of our students. So we can see the breakdown of races, and we can see white and non-white. As we know, we're a very diverse campus. So we're doing a lot of things to support diversity, equity, and inclusion already. There are things that we can continue to do. And I say this, you know I say this, especially if our skin is white. Demographic trends. So this is a direct quote from the section of the board report I wrote for the October meeting. 5-year demographic trends show us that the largest pool of prospective students will be minority students. They will be black and brown. We currently have the fortunate position of having a diverse student population, while many schools struggle to recruit minority students. Because we have learned and continue to learn from our students, we are in a position to do well with an increasing population of students of color. So we each do our part. The board's commitment, as we know, if I'm not committed as your president, and the board isn't committed as our governing body, we can't do this, not well anyway. They are committed. I've said this before, but just because today is the day to overview this, wanted you to be reminded that at the October board meeting, the board had a development session with two facilitators from outside of DC, and we talked about race awareness. Then in February, we talked about, with those same two facilitators, whiteness. And then, with the same two facilitators in May, we talked about engagement, or allyship. How can we, with permission, support people of color if we have white skin? It spells awe. It's how I remember what those sessions were. In the last two board meetings, we've talked about finances. So just globally, what the financial models are for campuses, what they look like, what the ratios mean, and about what those mean for DC in particular. We're done with those sessions. In May, we will be in person, hopefully, just like hopefully for commencement, and we will discuss mission and what it means for us in this world of cancel culture. What does our mission mean? What happens? How will the board support me, all of you, if a controversial situation happens? What can we expect? And how can we expect to be supported? What conversations can we be expected to have? How can we live in the uncomfortableness of those controversies? Because that uncomfortableness is A, learning, and B, necessary for us to meet our goal of being a national model for diversity, equity, and inclusion. Actions to date. As you know, after the murder of George Floyd, we set up a task force for anti-racism, and I asked Alicia Yakos Brown and Mercedes Clay to lead that task force. Many of you were involved in that task force, and at the end of a year of meeting, and very intense meetings, very good meetings, there were 11 recommendations that were given to me. And as you also know, those recommendations weren't meant to just be recommendations. They were meant to have action or potential action behind them. And one of those recommendations was to establish a committee, a college-wide committee, that would always talk about anti-racism on campus. So we did that. That became Be Real. Be Real stands for belongingness, racism, equity, accessibility, lifelong learning. Because this is a lifelong learning process. Whatever I thought I knew about diversity when I was a young professional has been challenged, and I have challenged myself through reading, conversations, to learn more. I read the book White Fragility. I read it with a friend of mine, same age, same pretty much life experience in terms of our career, student affairs professionals mostly. She's a black woman. I'm a white woman. We read White Fragility together. We had a little book discussion group, just the two of us. She said at the end of the book, "This feels really heavy. I'm not sure we'll ever get it done." I said to her, and name, "I probably need to apologize to you for so many things that I have said to offend you. Because that's what I learned as I read the book. What I thought I was, I probably wasn't. And I learned, and now I'm applying that learning." We can all do that. We are in the business of education. We added a chief diversity officer and named Mercedes Clay to that position. In addition, you'll also remember that we had two task forces that were board and faculty leaders and cabinet members. And those board committees worked in conjunction with us, and what the faculty actions were to look at learning opportunities, financial models for success, and then there's also kind of an overview, scenario planning and visioning group. So out of that learning opportunities task force, we have a lot of task forces going on, so I just want to clarify. Out of that learning opportunities task force, we took those four actions that the board did last year. There was a superintendent's licensure program. There was moving cybersecurity from minor to major. there was an engineering program in conjunction with University of North Dakota, and there was the addition of a faculty line for diversity, equity, and inclusion. Thank you, Dr. Barnes, for that suggestion in that committee as our faculty leader and as someone who understands what it is that we're trying to do. So a lot of task forces, but that's where, those were the four action items that came out of the learning opportunity and the work of the faculty that led to this faculty position. As you may be involved, you know that there are interviews going on right now for the candidates of who are interested in that DEI faculty position. So here's a summary of what that position looks like. Tenure track, he or she will teach 3 courses per semester, including 2 current offerings of cultural diversity and world issues. Other courses in the scholar's area of interest will also be offered, and will coordinate DEI efforts led by the president's office and work closely with the chief diversity officer for programming for 1 course release each term. So that's an overview of that position. And then we have our chief diversity officer, and this is an overview of her position. She reports to the vice president for student affairs directly to me indirectly. Responsible to coordinate, lead, manage, and strategically plan for college diversity initiatives. Work with campus leaders to address institutional and systemic issues related to DEI. So what in our, so when we look at this as a nation in our constitution, what is there, what laws are there that cause systemic racism to continue? On campus, what assumptions have we made in our policy development over the years that can be better addressed? Better, more inclusive. Create ways to promote a culture of belongingness. Assess, with 2 S's, sorry, and take action for, I saw that and didn't get back to it, sorry. Yes, it is not asses, it is assess. And take action for campus based on data from benchmarks, local and national surveys. She is also available to all candidates who come to campus for interviews to discuss their positions as it relates to DEI. So she can do that while the candidate is on campus. Sometimes the candidate opts to do that in a phone call or a virtual visit after the interview. So sorry for my thing, but at least we had some comic relief. Is that why your face was like this, Jen, when you saw that? So now it's my pleasure to introduce Mercedes Clay, who will talk a little bit about the work that we are doing as part of the Be Real Committee. So, Mercedes, please. Thank you.
Really quickly, well, just a overview. So Be Real has 4 subcommittees. One is accessibility, the other anti-racism, belongingness, and inclusion. And each of these 4 subcommittees has a representative from faculty, staff, student, and board members. And it was very important for us to make sure that we were inclusive of every representative group here on campus. And for some of these groups, there's also a community member, because eventually some of this outreach will trickle out into the community. Some current projects that we're doing right now, faculty and staff assessments. So that's one of the things that is very important to us, getting to know what you all want to know. What areas do we have a large gap in, and how do we fill those areas? Campus-wide diversity inclusion statement. We're gonna work on that, and that'll be something that's available for you all to look at, to contribute ideas to. We definitely want feedback from the campus, as this is going to be a campus-wide statement. And so we need people to be able to know it, but feel like they also had a say in it, so that you can take ownership of it. And that's very important. Continuing with DEI training, we're looking at several different groups and organizations to come in and do the training. There will be things that hopefully will be a blend of in-person and online, because we know that you are all busy people. One of the things that is really crucial, especially through the anti-racism group, is to create a brochure on what critical race theory is, and most importantly, what it is not. We will be working with the UCC, who is doing a lot of work right now currently on critical race theory. hoping to create pamphlets and flyers to hang around campus, but we also want to be able to distribute them in the community and work with the St. John UCC Church on campus to have open forums to have this discussion. Because I think a lot of things that are out currently in the media about what current critical race theory is not necessarily correct in all ways. And so we want to be the ones to debunk that those myths in this area. And also, finally, but sometimes most importantly, addressing crucial student needs. We know that based on our last presentation for Campus Connections, we had that conversation about what the students' needs are and how everything plays a part in their mental health and their ability to be successful here. So we want to continue to address those needs when it comes to diversity, equity, and inclusion. Some things to remember, DEI benefits everyone. And so in this work, we need you all to understand that everyone is included and everyone matters in this work. So we're looking at this in a very holistic point of view. Everyone has a say in what this looks like. Again, this is about taking ownership and everyone feeling like they have a piece of this and they understand what DEI is. And the work requires constant learning and adapting to change. As Chief Diversity Officer, there are still things that I'm working on. Pronouns and making sure that I'm saying pronouns correctly and making sure that I'm saying names correctly are things that I am constantly working on. And so sometimes you make a mistake, but feel free to know that you can allow yourself some grace for making mistakes. And the key to that is always intention versus impact. And so understanding what your intention was and owning up to whatever that impact is and correcting that and letting and acknowledging that you still have room to grow. In the process of being a national model, we are on the ground level. And everybody plays a role in what that looks like and how we change campus culture. We are visibly different, diversity-wise, than we were when I first started in 2003. People see that. People see that as you're just watching students walk across campus, as you're driving past campus on Clinton. We are visually diverse, but we are also diverse in so many other ways. And so we have to make sure that the culture of what we want it to be on campus comes from us. And so we are all responsible in what it looks like to change the campus culture. And it's connected to every part of our work, how we interact with students, how we interact with each other, how we interact with visitors on our campus, how we interact with news media even. It plays a large connection to what we want to accomplish to be the national model. And it's also crucial to recruitment and retention of students, faculty, and staff. In the area of students, students are looking for schools that are talking about diversity, equity, and inclusion. And as a school that has the ability to recruit the population of black and brown students, that is crucial. We have to be able to say that we know what we're doing and we believe in it, because what we know is students have a lot of other options as well. And we want to be their top option for school. As far as faculty and staff, I want to move from this notion of being satisfied employees to engaged employees. And so what that means for diversity, equity, and inclusion is that everyone feels like they have a stake in the game. They feel like they are important, because once you feel recognized and you feel important, you feel like you're wanted and you feel like you belong, you become more engaged in your work. And then the work becomes easier, in some senses, becomes easier. But it makes it more, it has a direct impact on how we wake up in the morning and how we approach our day and how we go through our day and we interact with students. It makes a difference. And it makes a difference how we, you know, end the day and go home and feel like we did a full day's work and are satisfied with what we have done. So we want to move from this thought of being satisfied employees to engaged employees. So these are just some things to remember, and there are constant things that will be changing, and we'll be talking about this throughout the year. And if you are interested in more of the work that we're doing for the subcommittees in Be Real, or have an interest in being a part of it, we always need more happy people to be on another committee. So if you feel like you have room to be on another committee, please make sure you see myself or Alicia, and we'll happily put you on the committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Mercedes. So to move on, Dr. Phillips uses this term, so thank you. I did check with her to see if it was okay to use. She uses the phrase, call in, not call out. I like it. I can't get it out of my head since I heard her say it. Because ours is not to shame, to call out. Ours is to promote learning and greater understanding. That doesn't mean we should be walked all over, and it doesn't mean we shouldn't assert ourselves. We can, and at the end I'll talk about this a little bit, take time to think about how to call in as opposed to call out. Because this work is uncomfortable for most of us, and we will not get it right all the time. And when I was making a presentation recently for the NCAA convention about DEI, Mercedes gave me something to think about, which is, because it was athletic in this case, it isn't about wins and losses, it's about wins and lessons. So if we can think of our missteps as places where we can learn lessons from each other, from ourselves, from our own reflection, then I think we'll be on the right track. How do we do that? Well, we listen to each other, including our students, before we respond. We read and we reflect. We invoke our empathy. How would it feel to be in that person's shoes? And we can start with some easier ones, and we can go to some very difficult ones, situations that we've all read about in the news. What we say and how we say it. Mercedes mentioned names. So I have a friend whose name, I learned it, two I's notice, two T's. I learned her name from her, so this isn't a story about misusing her name, it's a story about her name as she was told in America to say it versus how it's supposed to be said. I learned her name as Tina Pertu. After she and I, we were career colleagues, after she and I became friends, I learned that from her Finnish background, her real name is Tina Pertu. I always called her Tina after that, because it respected her and her heritage. It's an example of why names are important. Even though that name was okay with her, Tina honored her. Understanding terms. Racism, individual, systemic, and white privilege, what do they mean? Equity and anti-racism, what do they mean? Social justice and racial justice, what do they mean? How are they different? Inclusive pedagogy and culturally expansive teaching. When we talk about critical race theory, what we're talking about is telling a truer story of our history. You know the example I use. It's the women's right to vote. I learned in school women got the vote in 1920. Well, that wasn't quite the whole story, was it? White women got the vote in 1920. They fought hard for it. Women died. They went to prison. They were tortured to do that. Black women didn't get the vote until 1965, nor did black men. So the whole story is factual. We can tell the whole story. That's what critical race theory is really about, telling the full story. It helps us say, we didn't do it right, and we're sorry. We won't do it again. We haven't ever said that. Source there is an EAB email that was what we can say and how we say it. And then EAB also did an article with 4+ notions about how we can promote racial justice on campus. Institution-wide transformation. That's what we're trying to do. the four barriers, and EAB's hallmarks of an anti-racist institution. An anti-racism or an inclusion agenda is in strategy and operations. Faculty and staff are aware and are working. Campus climate is changing to be more worthy of belongingness. Student enrollment, co-curricular and curricular activities and courses, community partnerships, institutional culture, and that we use systems thinking. So those are some of the things that we, with the Be Real group, will be working on. Mental health. When we last met, Lynn Braun, I think, gave some very helpful ways to think about and engage, maybe helped us re-remember or helped us think differently about that, because there are so many ways and ways to work with students as we notice possible mental health issues. DEI issues can be a cause of those stresses and of anxiety. So adapting her suggestions and thoughtful ways to increase belongingness and inclusion is appropriate and it's possible. And if you want to relook at those notes, they would be in the campus update that followed the last campus connections. Incremental change. We become a redefined culture of inclusion, culture of belongingness, culture of diversity, because we make incremental changes. It's a ripple effect. The drop starts and it pushes out. And it isn't just what we're doing on campus. We all go out in the world and do our community work, our partnership work, our board work, whatever we're doing. Our students go out in the world when they leave us. Graduate school, their first professional positions. What we do here affects the broader society. So our good work has a ripple effect. We start where we are, work on those incremental changes, and keep moving forward. So in closing, some campus notes. We have congratulations to offer to two of our faculty colleagues. The Board of Trustees at their last meeting unanimously approved Dr. Joanne Burkhardt to be faculty emerita and Dr. Fred Coulter to be faculty emeritus. So let's offer our congratulations. Also wanted to note that we'll have some changes in food service and WFF leadership. We don't know who those folks will be yet, but when we do, we will announce that information. We'll give you that information. And some of you may or may not know this, Mike Keck left MetaLink. He was our campus. We all probably knew Mike Keck because he was our technology person. And MetaLink is replacing him. We don't know yet who his replacement will be. So we will announce that too, so you know who to call. Since November, we think we have the list since everybody else we have announced. So here we go in order of most recent joining of campus to the last hire we think we haven't announced, which was in November. So Janice Ivory is here. I saw her up there. She is the Assistant Dean of Enrollment Management and Director of Financial Aid. Janice, you want to stand up or wave or something? We welcome you. Billy Nickel, assistant football coach. Don't know if he's here. Not here. I'm getting a not here. So welcome him if you see him. DeGary Wallace, also football coach. Michael Beals, admissions counselor. There he is, right there in the middle. Anthony Morrow, did I say it right? Yes. Emily, I have to think about this. Aslaji, yes? Close? Okay, say it for us so we all hear it right. Aslaji, Harji. Aslaji, Emily's back there. She's our COVID campus support coordinator. Robin Ote, administrative assistant in STEM, right here. Teresa Watkins, welcome back. She's administrative in education and business. Benjamin Babcock, assistant baseball coach, back there waving with the baseball hat on. And Kirsten Nell, conferences and events coordinator. She's sitting right here. So welcome, everyone. We are glad to have you with our purple and gold Go Jackets. A couple of weekends ago, we hosted the indoor track and field championships, and we had kudos from our conference for doing such a nice job. So thanks to Derek Woodley, your staff and coaches, for getting that all set up, and well done. We were called out in our commissioner's note to the conference. And here are some pictures of our runners in action, compliments of our SID. Yay. And then upcoming events. After this event is a faculty staff awards luncheon for folks who have years of service in increments of 5. That will take place in the Hubbard Banquet Room. And if you have RSVP'd, please join us. Today is Ash Wednesday, so after that lunch, if you want to attend the Ash Wednesday service, it will be at 2 p.m. April 28th, we have the McMaster Symposium and Academic Colloquium coming up. Thank you. We have a Board of Trustees meeting the Friday immediately preceding commencement on May 14th. May 16th will be State of the College. And then July 26th, Jacket Summit, where we invite faculty, staff, and community leaders and business folks from the region to join us to learn more about what the workforce development needs are and how our liberal arts-based degrees can help feed the workforce in meaningful ways. So looking forward to that. As I end, I share this slide, which I used last time. Pause. There is power in space, in a breath, in a pause before you respond. You get to choose hate or love, anger or empathy, frustration or opportunity, lonely or together, irritation or understanding. Be kind. While I'm pausing, it brings me back to Dr. Phillips' call in, not call out. If we pause before we react, if we pause to respond, we can take that second or two to call in, not call out. And if I think about myself, I'd much rather, even if I'm being criticized, would rather have that conversation called into me as opposed to me being called out. That doesn't mean I do it that way all the time. It's a reminder that we can all do this, to call in something as opposed to call out. Grateful for the support, excellent work, as we embark on this, I think, admirable goal to be a national model for diversity, equity, and inclusion. It will take each and every one of us. It will take some boldness on our part. It will take some thoughtfulness and reflection. And it will take each one of us doing our own work to feel uncomfortable in a space. And then once you feel uncomfortable, you start to feel more comfortable. And then you take the next challenge and the next step. That's what we want to do today, starting today. Well, we've started a long time ago, but we want to really be mindful of this as we move forward. And I look forward to working with each and every one of you to do that, and for being called in when I make a misstep. Thank you very much. So now we have the service awards, and I rarely get done at 11:37. It's usually 11:57, so we have some time if we want to stay and talk, if we have questions or concerns that we'd like to address, and then head to the banquet room because it begins at noon. So if you have our SVP, we'll see you at the Service Awards Luncheon. Thank you very much for your attention and for your thoughtfulness. I see a hand. Okay. Okay. Thank you for the clarification. Yep. Yeah, I can't blame the other slide on you, the assess one. I'll own that one. I saw it and didn't get back to get it fixed. All right, other clarifications or questions? Yes. Great, so we thank you for the reminder. With your found time, you have time to walk through that space for a minute or two. Anything else? Great. See those of you at the luncheon who RSVP'd to be there. Thank you.